Good morning, everybody. Myself is Professor Dr. Rajendra Deshpande. We are in the Ayurveda College Nigdi, Pradhikaran, Pune 44. Today is a Tuesday, that is 31st of July 2017. And in front of me are the PG students. And now, although we are regularly learning the physiology or the medicine, today we have a little bit a different type of the video shooting, especially regarding the osteology. As you know very well, anatomy is sometimes, it is a little bit neglected part. Medical students more interested in the physiology, pathology and directly in the medicine. Anatomy they just do for the exam purpose, madam. So with me is my colleague, Dr. Mrs. Mahadhar madam. So I welcome Dr. Mahadhar madam. She is an expert in the anatomy and she is very popular in my college for teaching her skills and about osteology, etc. So today we are going to see the upper extremity bones, especially like humerus, radius and ulna. So step by step we will go further, as this is a very big topic and big portion. So I am not sure whether how many sessions will be required. So maybe we are going to make some short films, like 15 minutes film, because it is very easy to upload that particular film. So every after 15 minutes we will conclude and we will go for the next film. So I request Mahadhar madam, please start your lecture regarding the osteology, describing the humerus bone.
This is humerus. This is the type of bone, is the long bone. Now this is present in the upper limb. It is, as it is a long bone, it is studied in three parts: upper end, then this is the shaft, and lower end. Now we'll concentrate on the upper end. The upper end bears a head which is spherical in shape. It will articulate with the glenoid surface or glenoid cavity of the scapula. So here we will see the articulation and this will form the shoulder joint. Now the upper end will also bear...
Excuse me, I think the viewer should understand exactly the position. So I request my PG student to take a close-up view of how you are contacting that particular scapula and the humerus. That contact is very important, so you can make a close-up. Because this is the place where actually dislocation takes place. So, there is a capsule around that particular whole thing. Am I right, madam?
Yes.
And that capsule, if it is hardened, that particular phenomena is called the frozen shoulder. Here, you can see, where I am putting my hand, it's the same position. Am I right, madam?
Yes.
So, this is inside the bone. These are joined, the humerus is always joined with the scapula, remember. And what is the name of that cavity, madam, where it's attaching?
This.
Yes.
The glenoid cavity.
Yes.
And you must. Cup shape formed by the glenoid labrum. So here the articulation of the head of the humerus is taking place with the glenoid cavity and it will form the shoulder joint. This joint is ball and socket. So this is the ball and this is the socket.
Just a moment, I will repeat. Head and glenoid cavity. Please write down. Head. Please hold it, madam. Head and glenoid cavity. Two words are very important. And madam, I mentioned that head and glenoid cavity makes the shoulder joint. Yes, next madam.
The upper end also bears, this is the, on the anterior side, you will see when this tubercle is there, this is the lesser tubercle. And on the lateral side, again there is a tubercle, this is the greater tubercle. Now, how to identify whether is it of the left or the right side? So on the upper end, you will have a head which is directed medially. And it is directed upwards and little backwards. And the tubercle, lesser tubercle is directed anteriorly and lateral tubercle is directed on the lateral side. The lower end...
I will repeat. Everything is better that we can repeat two times. Huh? Madam will say one or two sentences and I will repeat it so that to make it a confirm. For example, madam is saying how you can identify. The students are asked, tell me whether it is right or left. Simple thing. He must take this humerus and try to attach to his body. For example, madam has mentioned that head should be on the medial side. Then we should understand what is medial and what is lateral. In this body, is it right that you are looking towards me? So this part is medial. So this head should face towards my this medial side. Now I am holding this. For example, I hold like this humerus. Okay. Head, where your head is going? Outside. That is lateral part. So definitely this is not from right side. This humerus can be easily attached to my right hand and you, left hand. So left humerus, this is the left humerus. Why? Because, remember only head. Madam has already mentioned the tubercle, but I will say head is very important. Head is facing, should be medial towards the heart. Now here, right humerus will be like this. It will on this side. But of course, there all the other parts should also consider. But head is the most important. It should face medially while determining the your right or left side. Okay.
One more point is there of side determination. That now you have fixed the upper end. On the lower end also, this cavity, this is called as the olecranon fossa. It is directed on the posterior side. So now this humerus becomes of the left side. So anterior, superior end will have head which is directed medially. Lower end will have the olecranon fossa on the posterior side. So we can identify this bone of the left side.
Remember again, next important thing, olecranon fossa. This is a depression. Fossa is inside. Fossa is depression. So this is olecranon fossa. This olecranon fossa should be on the back side. Remember, that is facing towards me, facing towards the patient, facing towards the student. And then you consider the head, where it is. So this is anterior and this is posterior. So olecranon fossa, can you get it in the video? This is deep part. Olecranon fossa, it should be on the back side. And then talk about the head. So this is about determination. So tell further important parts.
The upper end will bear head, then lesser tubercle, greater tubercle. There are two necks. Some of this spherical head is separated by the rest of the upper end by a neck. This is the anatomical neck. Now here the anatomical neck gives attachment to the capsular ligament of the shoulder joint.
One minute. This is
the green color you can see is the
can you get a ligament. Little bit, because there are two neck. One is anatomical neck and second is surgical neck.
Second is the surgical neck, which is separated from the upper end and the shaft. The surgical neck will separate the upper end from the shaft. And the clinical importance of this surgical neck is that there is the axillary nerve passing through the surgical neck. So whenever fractures of the upper end of the humerus take, we have to take precaution of this axillary nerve.
Just repeat, anatomical neck is around the head, remember. It is not going down, only upper part, anatomical, this neck is here. And then actually the neck is over here, surgical neck. So this is in between head and shaft. So upper end, shaft and lower end, these are the three important parts. And now madam has described the upper end.
One more feature is there in the upper end, that in between the lesser tubercle and greater tubercle, there is a sulcus. Is called as intertubercular sulcus in between the two tubercles. It is also called as bicipital sulcus or bicipital groove because the tendon of the biceps brachii passes through it.
Bicep muscle. Madam, tell something about bicep muscle. Bicep. For example, here on my body, this is bicep.
Biceps muscle is the muscle of the anterior side of the arm. It is the flexor muscle. It will do flexion and it will do flexion of this elbow joint. Now this biceps muscle, now this intertubercular sulcus will have two ends, two lips. This is the medial because it is nearer to the head. So this is the medial lip, this is the lateral lip, and in between there is the groove, or we can call the floor of the bicipital groove. Now these also give attachments to the muscles. The lateral lip will give attachment to the pectoralis major muscle.
This is pectoralis
coming from the chest and getting inserted on the lateral lip of the bicipital groove. Now there is one more muscle on the medial lip, that is the teres minor, which will come from the back and get inserted on the medial lip of the teres minor. Now this is the scapula, this is the muscle, this is the bone of the back. Now the inferior end of the scapula will give origin to the latissimus dorsi, which will get inserted onto the floor of this bicipital groove. So these three muscles will see, which have, there is two major muscles in between, there is a lady, that is latissimus dorsi. Two major are the pectoralis major and teres major. Okay. Now bicipital bite is called because biceps tendon passes through it. So it is called as the
bicipital. But there is no origin or insertion.
There is insertion in the floor.
No, bicep,
of the,
I am saying about bicep.
Yes, biceps origin is from the. Here you can see that there is.
No, but here in the groove, there is no origin or insertion.
Tendon
is passing. Remember, by the word bicep groove, it is not origin or insertion. It is only the tendon is passing in the bicipital groove.
Yes.
And then there is another attachment, is a chest muscle, that is pectoralis major. Here you can see on the video. And on the back side, there is a latissimus dorsi.
Now, the lesser tubercle will give insertion to the subscapularis muscle. Now this subscapularis muscle is coming from the scapula on this side and it is going and getting inserted on the lesser tubercle. Now here this is supraspinatus group. Here you will find the insertion of the supraspinatus on the greater tubercle. Supraspinatus, infraspinatus and the teres minor. Major has got inserted on the bicipital. So these are the six muscles around the shoulder joint. They will form the secondary shoulder cuff or the rotator cuff we say, that are the these three six muscles. Okay. So lesser tubercle will have three insertions. First is the supraspinatus, infraspinatus and the teres minor. And three muscles already we have seen, that was the, here was the pectoralis major and latissimus dorsi and the teres major. Okay.
Excuse me, madam will repeat, rotatory cuff is a very popular term in orthopedic surgeon. They always use this rotatory cuff and rotatory cuff injury is very very common. So madam will repeat, instead of taking madam, just give them list, which are the muscles they form the rotatory cuff.
Rotator,
we are interested only to know the names. Once again.
Rotator cuff will include, first muscle is the deltoid muscle.
Deltoid, number one.
Deltoid muscle.
Second.
Second is the supraspinatus.
Supraspinatus. Third.
Then infraspinatus.
Infraspinator.
Then teres major.
Teres major.
Teres minor.
Teres minor.
And subscapularis.
And subscapularis. Okay. Now, madam, tell us something about shaft.
Now, the shaft will connect the upper end with the lower end. Okay. Now on the upper side the shaft is bit a rounded structure and on the lower side it has become a triangular, expanded from side to side. The lower end is expanded side to side. So on the lower half it is somewhat triangular and the upper half is rounded. So it will have three borders and three surfaces.
I think madam, regarding the shaft, these three borders and three surfaces only you can write. Now we will directly go to the lower end because there are many important structure at the lower end. Madam, tell something about lower end.
Okay. Lower end of the humerus is expanded from side to side. Okay. So and or you will see one important structure on the left lateral side, that is the capitulum. This is the rounded structure.
And capitulum. You write down the spelling C-A-P-T-I. Capitulum.
And on the medial side there is pulley shaped structure, this is called as the trochlea.
Now, madam, please tell us the spelling.
T-R-O-C-H-L-E-A, trochlea.
Trochlea and capitulum. Cochlea and madam, please repeat it, because capitulum, what is the importance of capitulum?
This capitulum is articulating with the upper end of the radius here.
Write down, capitulum, attachment to the radius, that is most important.
That
capitulum.
Head of the radius to form the elbow joint.
Now tell us only, madam, remove it. Then tell us about the trochlea.
The trochlea is a pulley shaped structure. It will articulate with the trochlear notch of the elbow.
Are you getting trochlear notch? So these two structures are very important, capitulum and trochlea, because these are the attachments to the radius and ulna here at the elbow joint. These muscles are attached, these bones are attached to the humerus. Humerus is over here, radius and ulna over here, arm and forearm, arm, humerus. Now madam is showing all together. But remember, capitulum and trochlea. Okay madam, next structure
now,
in the lower end.
Yes, there are two more. This is the medial epicondyle and this is the lateral epicondyle. Medial epicondyle will come just below the head. Medial side is the head. The lateral epicondyle.
Medial and lateral epicondyle.
Now above the trochlea there is the ulnar notch or ulnar fossa and above the capitulum there is the radial fossa. When there is the flexion of the elbow joint, the head of the radius will go inside this fossa when it will get flexion like this. Now this is extension. Elbow joint extension, the articulation will be like this. But when it will become flexed, this head will go in.
Just remember fossa. Now we are, capitulum is finished now. Now she has mentioned two fossa. Radial fossa, ulnar fossa. Write down. Radial fossa, ulnar fossa.
Or it is also called as coronoid fossa. Because this coronoid process, it is taken inside this fossa.
But for simplification, radial fossa, ulnar fossa. Why? Why purpose? Flexion. This is extension. This is flexion. This is extension. This is flexion. Why this flexion is taking place? because radius and ulna come together with this fossa to the humerus. To the humerus.
Now, when there is full extension of this elbow joint, this olecranon process goes inside this olecranon fossa.
Extension.
Extension.
Madam is doing extension.
This
what is?
This is the flexion. And this is extension.
What is happening, madam, in the extension?
This olecranon process goes inside this olecranon fossa.
Olecranon fossa and olecranon process. Write down these two words for extension. Olecranon process. Repeat it, madam.
Olecranon process goes inside the
olecranon fossa. Olecranon process goes inside the olecranon fossa, and my hand will be like this. Remember.
This straightening of the upper.
Are you getting?
Bending or flexion of the elbow joint.
Now, before finishing our humerus, just madam, tell us something about any important nerves are there or important muscles are there at the lower end.
At the lower end, behind the medial epicondyle, there is the ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve, what it will, whenever you get injury to this, you will find a tingling sensation in the hand. This ulnar nerve is also called as musician's nerve because it supplies these two fingers.
Ulnar nerve, write down the word. Ulnar nerve, musician.
So, median 1.5 finger is supplied by the ulnar nerve. And it is also called as musician's nerve because during any playing an instrument, you use these two fingers.
Violin, for example.
Or sitar.
You have to use this little finger and ring finger. So, these are controlled by this ulnar nerve. That is why it is called as a musician's nerve, and that can be damaged because it is connected with the some part of the humerus. Remember, ulnar nerve, humerus. So there is a damage, there is a fracture, there is a diabetes. Whatever it, nerve damage will be there, then the tingling numbness will be in the ring finger and the little finger.
There is one more nerve connected, which will have the radial nerve.
Okay, so in this particular lecture, madam has explained you about this humerus. Basically, upper part, upper end, shaft and the lower end. And then she talked about some tubercles, fossa, head, etc., etc. Some important nerves are also covered, and some muscles are also we have covered. Now, in our next audio session, we can continue some of the part of the humerus, or we can directly go into the radius and ulna. So, thank you very much for patience hearing. Thank you very much, madam. We will see in the next audio session. Thank you.